Unless somebody finds a microphone, I'll have to move this way. It's worse, this one, right? So, very briefly, we're going to do something very different from our fantastic keynote, which at least got my mind working like crazy. Now you're going to work like crazy. Not with your mind, but with the first things that come to mind. What, as Jorijn already told, one of the deliverables of this project is a toolkit for museums working with ICH. Last meeting in Rotterdam, we started experimenting with what can such a toolkit look like? How do we make such a toolkit collaboratively with all of us? And one of the groups, I know some of the people from the group are here, I want them to raise their hands, they developed a super small, tiny little game about diversity, collections, intangible cultural heritage. It's a fantastic little game, and it had something to do with dice. Anyone remember who was in the dice group in Rotterdam? Yeah, you were. I want to play this game in a slightly adjusted version with all of you for just a few minutes. The reason why I want to do this is to get your mind thinking about what we're going to do this afternoon, which is collaboratively work on a toolkit that actually addresses many of the topics that are addressed here today. I don't think I have a slide. So the first thing you need to do is get a pen and a paper. You're going to write down something. It's very easy. You're going to write down a one. Uno, uno, a, uno, uno,
uno.
Uno. Yeah. Yeah. And you're going to write down celebration. Two, due, twek. No, probably not that in German. Spirituality. Three, knowledge and skills. Four, family. Three, knowledge and skills. Just make it knowledge. The first one was celebrations. Four is family. The second is spirituality. Oh, this is getting very complicated. Sorry. Four, family. Five, nature. And six, your profession. Our profession. Now, six also happens to be the number of sides on the regular dice. What I want you to do, I brought a couple of these. I want you to, I'm going to throw some of these dice to keep people. I'm going to throw one to you. I hope you can catch. Raise your hand if you really cannot catch a dice if it's thrown at you. You really can't, so all the other people can. I'm going to throw one to you. I'm going to throw, let's see. You want one? Yeah, sure. Yeah. You get one? No. You get one. Oh, I have two left. There's a group. You can catch, right? Oh, the person who had chicken. Oh, you can. I'm giving one here in front, right? So look at somebody around you who has a dog. Oh, there's one left. One left. Who wears really a shortage of dogs in the back, I think. Oh, well done. All right. So you roll the dice, and you tell a little something about your own experience, your own practice, or your own ideas about a topic that comes up. So you share a short story that says something about you, about a community you belong to, your identity, or the maybe your professional identity. And you tell a short story about that to your neighbors. When the story is finished, the next one rolls. Super easy. Super random, and it's a great opportunity to get to know each other. So look at somebody around you who has a dice, form a little group, start playing. In 5 minutes, I'll get the floor to your own. Goodbye.
It's going
to
be 5 hours.
Moi, je me souviens que j'étais
Okay, alright everybody. I know I've released your enthusiasm to talk and to work together and to learn more about each other. And there will be time to do that in much more detail this afternoon. Now, I'm just going to ask you, I'm pretty good at catching dice. So, if everybody wants to throw the dice, not all at the same time, one by one, back at me, and then we'll move to the next part. So, for the dice.
Whoa! C'è gente che ha girato in musica, un compound, sia per le stesse persone.
So we just launched a youth edition throwing dice to the okay, we come to the next section of our program today, in which we will learn more about five museums presenting their inspiring examples on intangible heritage and participation. As you all know, we work via calls, so people can present their case and we select it to share it at this international audience. I will briefly introduce the speakers, and then each speaker has 10 minutes, I'll try to watch time, to present his case, and after that we will have a group talk. First speaker is Siegfried Bosmans. Siegfried Bosmans is the director of the Museum Hof van Beusleben, and will present us a case, Beethoven is in Af, your tower is not finished, I don't know if I can translate well. Siegfried has a master in art history, and since 2005 she's the head of the department Museum and Heritage at the city of Mechelen, and she's the artistic director of the museum. Siegfried is also an active member in all kinds of expert groups, commissions, and civil society organizations. I speak from my own experience, being a close colleague to her now. And she's vice president of Het Firmament, an expert center on the cultural heritage of performing arts in Flanders, that has also a strong intangible heritage section. And then she's also at the board and an initiative taker of APPS, but she will talk more about this initiative in her talk, so I leave it to
I will talk to you about Your Tower Isn't Finished, which is an exhibition. And the exhibition is a part of a participatory museum trajectory. And it was inspired by a quote of Walter Benjamin, and that is, every image of the past that is not recognized by the present as one of its own concerns threatens to disappear irretrievably. And it's written a long time ago, but I think it's still today very relevant. Because you can change this word image to every object of the past or something intangible like tradition, but also you can apply it on an institution, like for instance, a museum. But what is interesting for me is how we recognize it as one of its own concerns. It is about giving meaning to something today, and that is always an interaction. An interaction between people and images, objects, traditions, but most of all, an interaction between people. The plurality of our options suggests that we always speak in plurium. The plurium means a diversity of images, meanings, values. Now, let's look at how this insight helped us to build the master plan for the museum and how Your Tower Isn't Finished fits into this. But first I'm going to talk about Mechelen, some practical information, because I can't imagine a lot of people know where Mechelen is. And so Mechelen, it looks large there, but it's really a small city, 80,000 inhabitants, and it's between Antwerp and Brussels. Now, the museum is located in the center of the city, in Burgundian Renaissance City Palace. Here you see only one wing, and the architecture of the residence of Hieronymus von Wiesleben was really in its heyday's groundbreaking. Now, to continue in this tradition, we built a contemporary exhibition space underneath the court garden. This is where Arthurian Isn't Finished took place. Here, you see two different pictures, one in of the beginning of the exhibition and one at the end of the exhibition. At the start, we had a fairly empty expo, but when we finished, we had loads of interventions of heritage organizations, but also visitors. They all put in interventions. So we had more than 53 organizations, had 40 activities in the exhibition, and in total, 73 objects were contributed. The expo was in itself an experiment in giving meaning to the city, its history, and the way the museum works. It is part of a whole trajectory, as I will show you. So, the expo was the final stage in a long-term stakeholders survey to define our museum and create a master plan. In fact, it was more than a survey, it was a dialogue between the museum and partakers ranging from opinion leaders from the diverse sectors, but also over midfield organization and heritage organization, till our own policymakers. We asked them what they needed to have in this museum. In Voorhout, we tried to define building blocks to talk about this museum making in phase one, because it's museum professionals and academics, because it's not very easy to talk about all these different ways of how you can look at the museum and its work. Now, at the end, refined it into an exhibition to ask the opinion of one of the important stakeholders, being the visitors. So, now how does intangible heritage come in? At first we wanted to focus on how we incorporated intangible cultural heritage in this exhibition. It appears in different ways in our museum's story. We added ICH ourselves to the exhibition in order to differentiate the story. For instance, here you see the jacket, part of the museum's collection. People normally see him only when he's carried in the organ. Now, you could climb the stairs and take a look into his eyes. We did not only present him as a static object, but we decided to show different perspectives and point of views on how we could look at this giant. People could collect different stories to make their own catalog. So one object was presented through different interviewees and showed multiple perspectives. For the giant, we had a story of the context of the history of the Omagan, the story of its object and its conservation, but we also asked the carriers of the giants to tell their story. We invited the visitors to look up, to look under the skirt of the giant to get a glimpse of the carrier's space. Now, the Carrion School of Mechelen was one of the heritage organizations that wanted to participate in the expo. We expected that they wanted to show their way of working, namely the transmission of the skill of playing the carillon. But when we asked them what they wanted to present, they suggested to put a large bell into the expo. We need skilled museum professionals to convince them to bring their practice into the museum. When they decide to hold their Carillion classes in the exhibition, we had a dynamic program in our museum, and they had the opportunity to tell the public about their passion. In this way we learned that the museum should keep in mind the effect you have as an institution and the strong connotations that coincide with the concept of museum as a place of objects. The funny thing was that a sport organization, in this case the Aikido Club, did not feel the same restrictions when they thought about how they would represent themselves in the museum. They were eager to show what they stood for, the transmission of skill and tradition of Aikido. They discovered the heritage site of their practice. The contribution of Paul Contrain reflected a close connection between his personal history and his passion, puppetry. His grandfather founded the first puppet theater in Mechelen. Paul used puppets and figures to take exhibition goers back into time. By discussing the materials used to make the puppets and how they are operated, he also told a story about the craft of the puppetry and the puppet making. Paul's contribution was linked in this respect to that of Circus Ronaldo. The Ronaldo family was not only described their history and their ties with the city in front of an immense circus backdrop, they also allowed their backdrops and the way they were made to play a leading role. In doing so, they brought their own collection and the craft associated with it into the city's museum. The process that went on beyond the scenes was perhaps just as important. Volunteers from Mechelen Museum and Heritage were trained to catalog the theater curtains of Circus Ronaldo, as well as the puppet collection linked to Paul Contrain. We helped them to look for ways to better preserve their heritage and, in case of the Ronaldos, research the way of painting, skills and techniques needed to paint on. This already shows the value of looking at intangible heritage in a museum setting from a holistic point of view and taking into account how our intangible heritage can be enriched by the functions of the museum and vice versa. It helped differentiate the story of the museum, and we did a visitor survey and discovered that a lot of visitors thought it helpful to have a diversity of interest into a subject. They liked the different stories, but they also liked the interaction with the carry-on players and the talks of the involved organizers because it gave them a more personal approach, a more intimate story. The museum practice, on the other hand, helped for some organizations to be aware of their heritage, to take them a step further in presenting it, researching it, or to safeguard the material aspects. An important lesson learned from Your Tower Isn't Finished is that visitors, nevertheless, expect powerful objects or stories. A pull factor for visitors is still often a masterpiece and not a participatory practice. And you see here images of Matt Maiden. We took this into account when we worked on Matt Maiden, because this is also the thing where we talked about the economic factors, and as a museum, you need visitors to visit your museum. Intangible heritage, I think we go for a shared museum, and intangible heritage focused on dynamics of sharing traditions, skills, etc. with people. We want to share our museum in order to shape it in unison with the city. Your Tower Isn't Finished worked as a multiplier, a differentiator for a collaboration and interaction of all kinds of heritage. It is precisely through this interaction that meaning is created. The creation of meaning involves all kinds of people and communities. Heritage communities, but also researchers, visitors, restorators, and I include now minority groups. If we take all parties into account, the museum becomes a safe haven where the complexity of a society can be presented. Often today, complexity is discarded. Museum Hofton Bussiada wants to show this multi-layeredness, the plural perspective and complexity. We can do this by presenting different points of view, different modi operandi, different ideas, side by side, but also by facilitating dialogue and debate. As a place where the image is pivotal, it becomes a key challenge to give shape to this multiformity. The process we undertake to guidance partners, artists, and communities is essential. A museum should be a platform for experiment and imagination. This means that we consciously create space for projects that focus on processes. The importance lies in that what can become, that what isn't yet, that what can be imagined, and all steps in between. That is why I would like to end with this painting of Thomas More, a good friend of Hieronymus van Bisschoppen and the writer of Utopia.
Thank you, Sigrid, for this inspiring case and sharing it with us. I'd like to introduce now Annemarie de Wild. Annemarie is historian and curator at the Amsterdam Museum. Her focus is on daily life, urban conflicts, culture and identity, with exhibition subjects like prostitution, Amsterdam songs, sailor tattoos, football as the new religion, neighborhood shops, graffiti, and so on. These exhibitions are characterized by a hybrid variety of objects, often a mix of high and low culture, a strong role for human stories, and a preference for co-creating exhibitions in dialogue with the people represented. Annemarie is also a blogger and publishes books, catalogs, and articles on the practice and dilemmas of curating and contemplating.
Very much. I'm going to talk about rhymes and rhythm, so it's nice to have the rain accompanying my story. Okay. So, is this? Well, thanks for being giving me the chance to be an inspiring example, and I also hope to be inspired by you, because I suppose a lot of the cultures represented at this conference have music deeply rooted into them. So, you know, please talk to me if you have any suggestions, etc. Amsterdam has a rich musical tradition. One of the most famous neighborhoods in musical respect is the Jordaan area. It's a now gentrified working class neighborhood. In the 19th century, it was called the Kingdom of the Slums. Look at the photo of a Clyde, on the wall by Clyde Woning. It'll come back in a song later. At that time, in the 19th century, the genre of the Jordaan songs developed. It was influenced by Italian opera, by French musettes, and with Yiddish words in the lyrics. Singers like Johnny Jordaan and Zwarte Riek revived the genre in the 1950s and 60s, and this was at a time when many people moved out of the neighborhood due to renovations. They sang about nostalgia for the old hood, about the joys and sorrows of life, but also about problems with money and the police. A project at the Amsterdam Museum planned for next year aims to shed new lights on these Jordan songs by juxtaposing them with another musical genre that also has foreign roots, hip hop. In local, all around the world now, local versions of hip hop in local languages have developed. Although very different in rhymes and rhythms, the Jordan songs share similar subject matter with hip hop. And for the exhibition, we want to explore two neighborhoods and two musical genres, Jordan and Belmer. The Belmer is a high-rise area that was built 50 years ago, and it became home to many migrants. Especially in the 1990s and 1980s, it was considered to be the ghetto of Amsterdam. Both areas share a sense of pride in their own neighborhood, but they also have a very negative image in the eye of outsiders. We will present the songs of both genres in the context of the neighborhood and where they were created and are being performed. Let's not talk about music, but I would like to listen to two examples. My lovely assistants, hopefully. Maybe we should put it in. Here, put it in. I'll finish it here. It was just to give you a little bit of an idea of the sound. I distributed some papers with the text of the songs. And I would like to move on. To the next one, just also, no, can you push it? So, yeah, okay. Sorry, can you, the film. Musical genres which we like to combine. Briefly, I want to tell you something about the obstacles in the project. As you may have seen, it involves a very diverse bunch of people, these ICH practitioners, traditional choirs that sing this Jordan repertoire in costumes that are reminiscent of clothing around 1900. And the fucking pop queers for whom these songs are very camp. But also musicians that continue this musical tradition, such as this accordionist, André Vrolijk, who actually owns the instrument of famous accordion player Johnny Meyer. And so very few hip-hop artists think of their music as intangible cultural heritage. And there, of course, is quite a distance between the world of museum and the world of hip-hop. We have encountered lack of interest or even hostility towards a museum that might try to appropriate their music to make money. Keeping it real, telling your own story is very important in hip-hop. So can you actually trust a museum to tell your story? Gaining trust and setting up collaborations are difficult processes. We hope to overcome these obstacles to some extent because of a collaboration with Top Notch, which is the leading Dutch independent hip-hop label. In 2016, they released a series of CDs of Parels of the Jordaan with this Jordaan music. And Top Notch wants people to listen to these songs not as nostalgia, but as songs that express something of life in the neighborhood. And he actually compares it, Snoop Dogg, with Johnny Jordaan, the one you just heard. So together we developed a plan to compare and contrast the Jordaan songs with present-day hip-hop. Some hip-hop artists are actually, on the other hand, and once some are hostile, others think it's very interesting to explore the neighborhood and their biographical backgrounds in the tracks, and to compare it with other musical genres, like your dance songs. They are proud to be included in the City Museum and realized that their own musical heritage can be considered as intangible heritage, although I usually avoid the term. I wonder also if they would be willing to embark on this process of heritage making. Another obstacle at the museum is to define, together with practitioners, what should be shown and what should be safeguarded. It's already mentioned, as a museum we tend to focus on the material culture in relation to music. So again, instruments, but also record players, in our case, boomboxes. The costumes of the performers, and so what actually is intangible cultural heritage? Is it the sound recordings? Is it the recordings of performances? Is it oral histories? And of course, an extra obstacle with music is copyright and legal ownership. To conclude, some positive aspects. The project will build on the network we established in 2006 when we made an exhibition about Amsterdam songs in the 20th, 21st century. Came back to Amsterdam. And this contributed to the safeguarding of both material and immaterial cultural heritage of Amsterdam songs. Archives, records, clothes, video recordings entered the collection of the Amsterdam Museum and the City Archives. At that time, we also explored the relations between songs and places, which is very important in both genres. In 2006, we made this analog map where visitors could actually plug in to listen to the songs of their neighborhood. And now we are working on an interactive music map of the city. And we also hope that our contacts with both academia and practicing musicians will contribute to this heritization process of popular music. Music, of course, is alive. Maybe new arrangements and sampling, also very important in hip-hop, are the most powerful way of safeguarding musical heritage. As a result of the meeting of young and old artists in 2006, this is the opening of the exhibition, hip-hop artists made a new version of the traditional song Amsterdam Huilt. So, the representing Malcolm Damsko, two words for Amsterdam, aims to build bridges, musical, geographically, social, and over time. The project will connect the present Amsterdamers, including expats, to musical heritage and social history of the city. Tracks from the Bijlmer can introduce people to an area they don't know or even fear. To compare and contrast both genres, hopefully will encourage new views on tradition, on changes and global influences. Visitors are invited to leave their musical and geographical comfort zones. We hope music will foster social cohesion and therefore will include participatory elements also in the exhibition, such as karaoke, that will include both genres, because the best way to learn about songs is to sing. Thank you.
museum curator and director of the Museum of Brittany in Rennes Metropole since 2012. Her formation is in history, political science, and a specialization in direction of cultural projects at the Institute of Political Studies at Grenoble, and then within the National Institute of Heritage in Ireland. Over the course of her career, she has acquired expertise in the field of society museums and in the management of heritage institutions, cultural mediation, and exhibition making. Between 1998 and 2010, she was in charge of the Museum of the Bresse in the area of the Planon, which raised her interest in the anthropology of food and culinary practices. Since 2017, she became chairman of the Fédération des Musées et des Musées de Société, and she will present a project Sortant des Clichés.
Good morning. So my name is Céline Chemez, and I will speak about an experience for the Federation of École Museum and Social History Museum. Just a few slides to show you who we are, the Federation of French École Museum and Social Society Museum. It's a network, and we are more than 120 members and about 170 museums. One part our local museum or regional museum, some are Musée de France and some not. You have a map of the French network. It's all over in the country. And we are an association which is supported by the Ministry of Culture and Communication. And we have lots of partners. So we have an organ of representation, a collaborative platform, and a center of expertise for this museum. We organize professional meetings about ICH, about museum and participation. So you can see the meetings. So, Sortons des Clichés, I will start with a short description of this project. The UNESCO Convention on Intangible Cultural Heritage has introduced a novel redistribution of balance between researchers and the local population, and therefore cease to be the objects of studies or potential visitors and become the major players. The fans was curious to see how those museums, which has always addressed questions of living cultural expression, of memory and transmission, are taking advantage of a new tool to protect our heritage. The FEMS proposed to lead an original research project about ICH, especially to connect society museums, communities, Bar Floréal, Jean-Christophe Bardot and Olivier Pasquier. The topics were suggested by members of the Federation Network. The project had a documentary ambition, but also aimed at producing a sensitive and distanced interpretation. This is another way, so to speak, neither the museum discourse nor that of the communities. So, what ICH are we talking about? Oral traditions, songs, dances, festivals, rituals, recipes, these practices inherited from the past but still very much alive are part of what UNESCO calls intangible cultural heritage. This approach is one that is familiar to social history museums, which has always asserted a civic commitment to preserve and promote our heritage alongside those creating it. As Florence Pizzorni reminded us in her recent report on museums in the 21st century, Social history museums relate to the idea of the laboratory museum initiated by Georges-Henri Rivière. As such, they are tools for a given population to understand what unites people and territories and to imagine the future by finding inspiration in heritage. They have been collecting every life object for a long time. The identity of these museums is defined more by the methods used to give meaning to the public collection territories interface than by the collections themselves. The Society Museum are very keen on involving the locals in their projects. The photographers were free to deal with the subject as they saw it. However, guidelines were given by a scientific committee within the Federation. They have taken photos all over the country. In the space of 11 years, they have made more than 500 photos and follow 13 different communities. The photographers worked on subjects as diverse as the Dunkirk Carnival, the island of red salt production, the bullfight in the land region, the making of pomme, and the Festnoz night festivals in Brittany, the festival of the cooperation of weavers in Charlieu, fishing in the Dombes region, the nativity place in Provence, the Hindu god Ganesh in Paris, and the Gay Pride March. One of the main challenges of these works was to show how these traditions, which are mostly inherited from time immemorial, actually results from a profound desire to keep them alive. Traditions evolve according to the way each generation sees its past. They are regenerated by new needs, new collective projects, and a new imagination. By recording these living practices, which are constantly recreated by the different communities according to the social background, the interaction with the environment and the history, the photographer proposes a reflection on modern times, which is far from being a folkloric or even an endorsing one. The subject dealt by the Museum of Charlieu around the Festival of the Corporation of Weavers is significant. The silk industry, which made the town famous from the 19th century, is almost inexistent today. The festival, which doesn't reflect an industrial reality, is very lively and attracts more and more people each year and has managed to reinvent itself. In keeping with this idea, pomme jam making shows how the tradition has been lost for several decades, can be brought back to life to satisfy new socializing needs. Pomme comes from typical Ille-et-Vilaine cooking. It's a kind of jam which is made by cooking slowly apples in hot cider for 24 hours. It was slowly abandoned, but the recipe was revived in the 18th by an association supporting Breton folklore. This event has been updated in many villages in order to create local interest. It's very popular with the locals because it gives them the opportunity to meet and share with other generations to the sound of Breton music, song and dance. After the documentary Sortons des clichés, we imagine different ways to promote this collective action. I said the documentary lasted 11 years. It involved more than 30 museums, the scientific teams or mediation, as many different communities throughout the country, invested in a live practice, and of course, the two photographers. After being on site, the Thames imagined several projects to valorize his vision at a given moment. First, a temporary exhibition at the Albert Kahn Museum in Boulogne, a museum specifically concerned by the photos and the approach of the cultural diversity in its scientific and cultural project. A window display showing both text and photo, and now an itinerary exhibition. All museums belonging to the FEMS can borrow it at no cost, and others can rent it for 1 week or several months. A review of the action was also carried out with the publication of an article in the magazine In Situ. Our setback is still insufficient, but overall we can evaluate this project as very positive for the network. As a positive effect, we can see that the project has reinforced the knowledge of the museum involved with the intangible cultural heritage of territory. It allowed to update the speech that museums could hold, but also to link museum professionals to the community currently involved in these practices through the approach with photographers. On the scientific level, it has also made it possible to create a corpus of documentary photos which document the practices. It's therefore a material heritage that is also given to this living heritage. As obstacle, as we say, that the project was long and complex, long to map with the museum of the network, and after to create the different displays. With the link with those communities remain in the future, unfortunately no assessment was made at the end of the project due to a lack of resources. So thanks to this symposium, we hope to be able to do it very soon. Especially this year, where the itinerary exhibition is being shown in several museums all over the country. Thank you.
Thank you, Celine. Our next speaker is Rosario Pericone. We already were introduced to Rosario. Rosario is a professor of cultural anthropology, museology, and museographical display at Palermo's Fine Art Academy. He's an expert of the history of folk traditions, theatre, and visual anthropology, and president of the Association for the Conservation of Folk Traditions and the Association Festival of Migrant Literature. As we already know, Rosario is also director of the museum here and the Ignazio Burdito Foundation. Rosario adopts a scientific and multidisciplinary and transcultural approach for the study and promotion.
Perché non custodisce oggetti desueti, perché questi cubi, queste marionette che vedete qui non sono oggetti non più in funzione, ma al contrario, questo museo è un soggetto attivo nella trasformazione del patrimonio immateriale che custodisce. Una trasformazione che, come voi ben sapete, non vuol dire l'oblio del passato, al contrario, vuol dire una trasmissione delle pratiche immateriali che sono rifunzionalizzate e attive e costruttive all'interno della società contemporanea. Perché io ritengo, purtroppo, che non tutte le pratiche culturali immateriali si possano trasmettere per il futuro. Perché è sempre stato così e così sarà. Ci sono alcune cose che si trasmetteranno e altre no. Quindi forse bisogna dirlo chiaramente questo. E che queste pratiche immateriali non sono un fatto di permanenza del passato nel presente, come voi ben sapete, una sovrapposizione in atto, il lascito di un'epoca globalmente conclusa. Esse sono tradizionali in quanto essenza di cambiamento in un contesto di innovazione. E come ben sapete, ogni cambiamento si attua su un fondo di continuità e ogni permanenza implica delle variazioni. E allora la tradizione, questo termine, questa parola, diciamo che ormai non si può più usare, che si suppone essere conservazione, manifesta, ha da sempre manifestato una singolare capacità di variazione e consente un ampio margine di manovra a coloro che la gestiscono, cioè a tutti quelli che noi e che oggi qui sono ben presenti in questo convegno, perché in realtà non è il passato a produrre il presente, ma è il presente che modella il suo passato. Io potrei chiudere qua il discorso e non continuare più, perché ritengo che su questo e anche su quello che ci siamo detti stamattina vada fatta una lunga riflessione, e penso che poi il proseguo di questa discussione venga fatto, perché se ha senso avere qui i portatori, le comunità di pratica, ha senso solo se noi gli diciamo che forse è bene che loro modifichino, cambino, attivino, innovino, perché ha senso questo sempre su un mondo ovviamente chiaro e evidente di continuità. Permettetemi la parola agli amici antropologi, di struttura. Ok, adesso, dopo questa, diciamo, vi voglio brevemente parlare del Museo delle Marie Mezze. Questo è il fondatore, Antonio Pasqualino, insieme a Jan Wilbeck, che è qui presente, e che vedete in quell'altra foto con il marito, all'inizio di questa avventura, cioè stiamo parlando del 1900, alla fine degli anni 50, inizio degli anni 60. La fondazione che gestisce questo museo è stata istituita nel 1965, quindi quando ancora non si parlava di salvaguardia del patrimonio immateriale, che era una cosa alquanto, diciamo, strana, direi molto strana. E da quell'esperienza è nato questo museo, inizialmente con la collezione di pupi che Antonio e Jan hanno raccolto durante le loro lunghe permanenze sul campo e ricerche sul campo con i pupari allora attivi, e poi il museo e la raccolta nasce prevalentemente per un fatto di riproposizione della tradizione. Che cosa voglio dire? Jan e Antonio scrivono, e Jan ci racconta sempre, che a un certo punto a Palermo e in tutta la Sicilia non c'erano più compagnie di pupari attivi, funzionanti, cioè non c'era più una comunità di pratica, per dirle con le parole che utilizziamo oggi. E i pupi, tutte le scenografie, quello che noi chiamiamo il mestiere del puparo, cioè tutto quello che compone poi il teatro, veniva venduto a pezzi, a spezzoni, agli antiquari, eccetera. In quegli anni, negli anni 60, proprio nel 65, gli anni Antonio, il professor Buttitta e tanti altri intellettuali fondano questa associazione che si chiama non a caso Associazione per la Conservazione delle Tradizioni Popolari. I nomi, come mi insegnate, non sono, diciamo, di secondaria importanza. Perché? Perché bisognava conservare, ma conservare per trasmettere, per far riprendere quella tradizione dei pupi, dello spettacolo, dell'opera dei pupi siciliani, che ormai non era più attiva, non erano morti i pupari, non era più funzionale lo spettacolo, cioè non permetteva agli operatori di guadagnare il minimo indispensabile per poter vivere di quel mestiere, perché era cambiato il mondo, c'era stata una rivoluzione con l'arrivo, diciamo, dei mass media, e allora quello spettacolo dell'opera dei pupi che questa sera vedrete, che era uno spettacolo a puntate, cioè ogni sera veniva messo in scena uno spettacolo diverso, e quindi ogni sera c'era lo stesso pubblico che seguiva spettacoli diversi. Con l'arrivo dell'arte dei mass media non c'è più un pubblico, il pubblico segue altre esigenze, segue altre vie, vuole raccontare altre storie e segue altre storie. E allora Antonio e Jan e tutto il gruppo che ha fondato l'associazione in quegli anni, che cosa fanno? Iniziano a spiegare, a dire ai pupari che devono cambiare il repertorio, che non possono più fare degli spettacoli di lunga durata che durano 365 puntate, perché se il pubblico è diverso e se il pubblico è sempre uguale, lo spettacolo deve essere sempre diverso. Adesso il pubblico invece è sempre diverso, ogni giorno c'è un pubblico diverso, che può essere il pubblico delle scuole, dei turisti. Allora bisogna fare uno spettacolo totalmente diverso, uno spettacolo breve, conciso, dove vengono messe in scena le azioni, diciamo, dove la lingua non diventi un un blocco per chi non conosce l'italiano, e quindi si mettono in scena spettacoli più brevi dove l'azione drammatica, performativa, le lotte, le battaglie, che sono delle cose che non hanno bisogno di nessuna, diciamo, traduzione verbale, sono evidenti in scena. Quindi si modifica questo spettacolo, ma grazie a questa modifica questo spettacolo si rinnova, va avanti, cresce. Poi ognuno, ogni paro, ogni attore che mette in scena gli spettacoli prende le sue vie, di arte contemporanea, di performance contemporanea. E alla fine degli anni 90, con la dichiarazione del 2000, con l'inserimento dello spettacolo dell'Opera dei Pupi come patrimonio orale, come capolavoro del patrimonio orale immateriale dell'umanità, quindi prima della convenzione UNESCO del 2003, grazie a questo riconoscimento nascono nuove compagnie in Sicilia, nuovi, giovani, vedete qui in sala, ci sono gli amici di Siracusa, c'è Enzo Mancuso che è là sotto, cioè si rinnova un percorso da tradizioni vecchie, di vecchie tradizioni, della tradizione familiari, dove c'erano comunque permanenze, dove c'era il nonno che aveva messo in scena gli spettacoli, ma non certo per trasmissione diretta, cioè utilizzando nuovi tipi di trasmissione e di acquisizione del sapere che noi chiamiamo immateriale, che non è più solo legato alla cultura orale, ma è mediato ovviamente da tutte quelle forme intermedie tra scritto orale che inevitabilmente ci sono oggi e c'erano anche allora nella nostra società. Allora, tutto questo è il lavoro che ha fatto il museo. E che sì, ho finito, anche perché non vi faccio vedere i pupi che vedete, quindi lo sapete. Oltre a questo, e questa è la cosa fondamentale e importante che secondo me il museo ha fatto fin dalla nascita, e poi negli ultimi anni abbiamo cercato di fare cosa? Abbiamo cercato di fare quello che tutti voi avete detto oggi prima di me. Che cosa abbiamo cercato? Abbiamo cercato di aprire il museo alla comunità, come avete fatto un po' tutti, come avete raccontato un po' tutti. Abbiamo soprattutto aperto il museo a far parlare dell'Italia, abbiamo fatto diventare questo museo, secondo me, un luogo che oltre a di conservazione e di documentazione è quello che ho chiamato come titolo di questo intervento un museo della performance. Un museo della performance che è dove ogni giorno, e lo posso dire senza possibilità di essere smentito, cioè ogni giorno dell'anno c'è qualcosa, uno spettacolo, un incontro, un laboratorio, una mostra, un incontro con i ragazzi della scuola, e questo crea comunità. Questo aiuta anche le diverse compagnie che si alternano sul palco che è dietro di voi, che stasera vedrete, ad avviare strade autonome, li aiuta anche a creare rete, a fare quella parola brutta che nessuno vuole più pronunciare, sinergia tra persone che hanno tanti problemi e anche conflitti molto spesso, perché è giusto che ci sia un confronto diretto. Molto spesso con Enzo abbiamo dibattiti belli, diciamo, vigorosi, perché lui, vedete, lui è quello lì l'ascolto, lui è bello robusto, quindi devo stare attento, ma anche con tutti gli amici. Ma è giusto che sia così, che ci sia un dialogo, un dibattito. Ecco, penso che il ruolo del museo e il ruolo del nostro museo all'interno di questa comunità è questo, e spero che di continuare a ampliare questo ruolo di apertura e di attività verso la cittadinanza. Vi ringrazio.
Is the curator of the Museum of Ethnography in Neuchâtel in Switzerland since 2006, and since 2007 he teaches also visual anthropology at the Institute of Ethnology at the University of Neuchâtel. His research projects are focusing on political anthropology, theater and representation, carnival, rural anthropology, museology and visual anthropology. Since 2005, he has been leading a deep video fieldwork project in the Rötschental in Wallis, and this project on paradoxes and ambiguities of intangible heritage includes an edited volume in Ethnographique.org, an archive collection, video installations and short films for museums, a documentary, and in production a thesis, but he will tell us more about it.
So thank you for the invitation and to let me speak about this project, which is not linked with the Museum of Ethnography in Neuchâtel, but it was a known project and mostly linked with a local museum in the valley of Lechenthal, which is a little valley, which is a paradigm of the closed valley in Switzerland, the closed alpine valley in Switzerland was meant like that. It's a valley with 1,500 inhabitants, and in this valley there is a very well-known carnival, which I filmed since 2006 till 2007, so 11 years of filming, every year coming back and having discussion with mass carvers, because this valley is well-known because of this wooden mask, and also that's a performer during the carnival, which is from the 2nd of February till the Ash Wednesday. And so this carnival is much followed, so there's a lot of people coming to film, to photograph, and since quite a long time. And it's also perhaps the most ethnographic tradition in Switzerland. So dealing, when you had to deal with that in a video project, so you will have, it will raise a lot of questions. So this video project is linked with the Museum of Kiepel, so it's a museum of the valley, which is led by the three communities, so the three villages, so paid by the three villages. So it's a common museum, which opened at the end of the 70s, and which is now led by Thomas Antonietti and Rita Kalbematen. Rita Kalbematen is come from the valley, and Thomas Antonietti is coming from not far away, but he was much involved in the intangible heritage project in Switzerland. He was even part of the group who choose the five last items who had to be presented, or seven items that had to be presented to the UNESCO list. Perhaps just to remind you that Switzerland ratified the convention in 2008, and in 2012 167 items were already chosen as a list. And during that same time, at the Museum of Neuchâtel, we work in a project to think about the paradoxes and the problematics of the process of choice. And we had three exhibitions on this topic. One was called Brie, and just to think to show you how we deal with that, we put a trad ice, so it was a machine to freeze the tradition, and to think about this paradox of documenting a tradition and freezing a tradition. So it was, we play with that. And this kind of problematic of essentialization that we all already are confronted with when we're dealing with immaterial intangible cultural heritage. And in the fieldwork and work, I think there is a lot of question. As I told you, this is a much documented carnival, and also there are a lot of images that the product is linked with advertisement, tourism, and that kind of thing, or artists which are impressed and use that kind of things. For example, here you've got some advertisement for medics or some kind of thing playing with a savage mind or savage obvious. Yeah, just two. For example, the little one here is just to hide the winter, to chase the winter and chase the flu out of you. So just playing with that kind of. So the carvers and performers are always in a kind of there to deal with the external images, like a lot of tradition, a lot of social practice. But here they really have to deal with a kind of projection from the outside, and even from artists. This is a horror film made by a French in 2000. 2009, which deal also with this figure, impress and plot. So there is a lot of irony that I could document in the film, and if you take 10 years and just film, come back every 10 years, it's tristen too, so it's obvious that you will see the changes. And here, for example, you just can see that the irony in the carnival is also developed because they make a Che Guevara photo studio. Oh, the name of the figure is a Che Guevara, so this is the name of the figure of the carnival. And then here they made, during the carnival, a Che Guevara photo studio, so it's what they're playing also with the performance of being photographed. And during this fieldwork, we collaborate a lot with a local museum. So I began this work with Suzanne Chapa, who is an anthropologist, a Swiss anthropologist, a specialist on carnival, and we work together at the beginning. And here you see we open in the local museum a space dedicated to masks with carvers, and so three persons here are carvers, and here this is Thomas Antonietti representing an old mask from the Swiss collections that is presented in his museum. And so there is a lot of interaction between the museum and practitioners, the carvers and also the performers, about all, because also there's a lot of documentation as ethnologists, anthropologists were here since 100 years. So there is that kind of dynamics between the carvers and the local museum. And with our films, we just collect the discourses, not only the performance, but also the discourses of the carvers, so to have the intangible part of that. And it was a nice moment because with the editing of the film, so it's just a thing, what we can do with the film, we can have various people and various discourses in the same editing, so in the same place. So we can have the conflict, we can have the debate. And this was the case because there is a lot of debates between the carvers and also between the performers, because there is also a prize in parade. So who won the prize, who is the show with the most beautiful figure, and all that kind of questions are very lively questions for people. So it's not so tragic, but it can be very in conflict about that. And they are very in conflict about the fact, about the aesthetic of mask. For example, what is an authentic mask of Legenda? Is it an old traditional one, so inspired by old photographs, or can it be inspired by horror movie or art rock aesthetic? And in the 90s, some sculptures, some carvers, just made a lot of masks with art rock aesthetics, kind of controversy. And we filmed this controversy and we projected that in the museum, and it helped us to formulate the debate and to have this conflict in the screen. In fact, when it was, because the Che Guevara are in the Swiss list for intangible heritage, and in fact, Suzanne Chapa and Thomas Antonietti were responsible for the canton, so the state of Valais, for list, they introduce in the argumentation the fact that debate is important, and that this is because it's lively, because people are in conflict, that's important. And they introduce that in the argumentation. If you go on the website Tradition Vivante, Living Tradition, which is a Swiss website for the intangible cultural heritage items, you will have this argumentation, which is quite part of it. And we just present it just to show you, see the same mask made by the carver here, inspired by hard rock figure. And we use that in the museum, in an exhibition that was called Helvetia Park, was on a cultural debate on Switzerland in 2009. And we use that on, it was a ghost train about the cultural controversy in Switzerland. And it was the main figure in the middle here. And so you can, you could really go in the ghost train, and there were all these cultural controversy about that. Just to finish, on this project, I just produce a lot of various videos for the museum in Kiepe. So they were used as a point of for the debate. And on various topics, for example, on all the performance of the body performance of this figure, and but I also, because in all the process we give images back to the people, so every rushes were given back to the people, or interviews rushes. If we're just being in the street, it would be impossible to give to everybody things, but interviews and that kind of thing. And so there is questions about the role of the filmmaker in that kind of thing. The filmmakers, for example, as a producer of souvenir, because in 10 years you had a lot of relationship with people, and then you made for example a little film on this little girl who made a first mask in an important moment for the day, because it was the opening of a collective carving workshop for tourists. So they tried to develop that kind of workshop in 2010, and so you can travel and just make a mask and that kind of thing. And I filmed this little girl because mainly the people of the carver are men, and there is one woman that mainly they are men, and I thought it very interesting to have a little woman just carved. It's first, so the question of gender also is here, but it's my point of view, so it's the point of view of the filmmaker in that case. And so that kind of films are, so here I just finished in 2 minutes, but the conflict can come back, because, and the question of representativeness, who is the master of the authorized discourse is always complicated. And in January 2016, another museum opened in the valley, and another museum led by one carver, and also with part of the performance, with a lot of friends. He just made a lot of figure during the carnival, and his family, they want to be the masters of the discourse. And I film them a lot because they are very interesting, they develop very sophisticated discourses on the tradition, so I had a lot of strong relationship with them, and I film them a lot. But then they asked me to make for them a film for their museum, and mainly I work with other museum, which is more local, it's not only for the fact. So that kind of problem that we can have in the situation where we're dealing with local actors. I had to make a film because in another way I will lose the relationship with him, and I can't use then the images that he gave me. So that kind of paradox, that kind of problem that I wanted to raise in the collaboration problem, but I think it reached a lot of what we discuss, what was presented in the first keynote talks. So, for if I think.
Thank you. Thank you all for very fascinating and sharing strong experiences. We were expected to have half an hour of discussion, but actually I imagine all of you are very hungry. So let's make it 15 minutes and give the opportunity to... is that fine or not? To give you the opportunity to raise some questions. What I learned from the talks, and it relates to things that were mentioned already, is that the different museum practices take different roles in relation to the way of implementing or using or having a relation to intangible heritage, but also to the participation question. And that in all the cases, there are different positions or roles taken by the museum professionals in that. It also struck me that a lot is about visual anthropology and about the visual. Maybe that's also a question of how it relates to that other question of representing and the participation of community groups and individuals in the way of presenting and representing their identities or their practices and so on. So it raises a lot of questions already, but I don't want to dominate the questions. Let's first open the floor and see who has a specific question or a general question, mostly focused on, of course, the topic we try to look at, the topic of participation and intangible heritage in museums.
Salve, grazie anzitutto per questa esposizione. Sarò velocissimo. Ho due questioni, una per Sigrid e una per Rosario. La prima solleva un tema che è legato al rapporto tra la materialità degli oggetti e l'immaterialità degli oggetti. Mi è piaciuto il punto in cui tu provi a dimostrare come le persone e il pubblico danno senso agli oggetti che stanno nel museo. Questo apre uno scenario abbastanza complesso per noi antropologi, che è quello della prima, della seconda, della terza, della quarta e della quinta vita degli oggetti. Per noi è un dibattito che è abbastanza noto, che tocca gli studi di Alcione Alpadurare, tocca Remo Budei, però insomma questa connessione tra la materialità degli oggetti e l'immaterialità degli oggetti non è una connessione univoca, scontata, che esiste una volta per tutte, ma gli oggetti prendono, acquisiscono e mutano senso, come dire, di minuto in minuto in base alle persone che li vedono. Invece per Rosario un'altra suggestione, ho condiviso tutto quello che hai detto fin da stamattina, cioè dall'introduzione. E è un'esperienza molto simile a quella di questo museo per uno studio abbastanza corposo che abbiamo fatto sul Teatro Popolare in Umbria, su Segala Vecchia. Ed è successa una cosa abbastanza simile, cioè una forma di teatro praticamente in via di scomparsa è stata di fatto riattivata negli anni attraverso nuove forme di significato, ma paradossalmente, devo essere molto sintetico, è successa la cosa opposta a quella che tu hai spiegato al pubblico. Cioè qui si sono ristretti i tempi, si sono cambiate le tematiche, invece in Umbria Segala Vecchia sopravvive attraverso la folclorizzazione delle feste paesane, dilatando i tempi, dilatando i canovacci e in qualche modo rimodellando le tematiche alla contemporaneità, ma sotto una forma di estetizzazione. Quindi volevo sottolineare come la sopravvivenza, anche in questo caso, delle forme di patrimonio culturale immateriale può assumere moltissimi aspetti e differenti direzioni. Grazie.
So we didn't think about tangible or intangible heritage when we started our museum participatory trade. We just looked at all the organizations who were in our city and we invited them. So and then we talked about them more for what they want to bring in our museum or what they want to be important. And from there on, we looked if it was tangible or intangible. So we didn't, we looked at it in, we didn't make the division when we started. And what about the acquisition of meaning? I think it's necessary always for tangible as well as intangible heritage to have this evolution in meaning, and I think a museum can be a good place to be a platform for the dialogue and to initiate the dialogue to give meaning. I don't know if that answers your question.
Pensavo che la prima domanda fosse per me, invece la seconda.
Ok.
E sarò, cercherò di essere breve, perché la tua domanda è una domanda, diciamo, molto complessa. Allora, secondo me è successo il contrario, dopo quello dei pupi rispetto a quello che dici tu, perché l'opera dei pupi non è più un rito, non è più una performance rituale, come l'aveva definita il mio maestro Antonio Buttista in un saggio, diciamo, introduttivo al libro Professore Pasqualino, cioè il rito dell'opera dei pupi. Ecco, siccome l'opera dei pupi non è più un rito, tu hai parlato, sei la vecchia, teatro popolare, sì, inserito però in un contesto prettamente rituale performativo. Quindi ecco perché secondo me è successo questo. Molte pratiche rituali in Sicilia sono invece diventate pratiche rituali folcloristiche, o comunque si sono standardizzate. Esempio classico che io faccio sempre, tirandomi dietro gli strali di tutti i sindaci e gli assessori del comune di Saleni, in provincia di Trapani, è la festa di San Giuseppe a Trapani, scusate, a Saleni, in provincia di Trapani. Perché dico che questo aspetto della festa è ormai sclerotizzato e quindi non più funzionale, quindi folcloristico, ok? Poi lo uso. Sono anni 70, lo so, però perdonate. Folcloristico. Perché quella festa lì a Saleni prevalentemente viene ritirata ogni anno perché ha cambiato la funzione e si è trasformata in festa prevalentemente turistica. Quindi non accoglie più gli aspetti innovativi che la tradizione, come ho detto poco fa, ha all'interno. È paradossale, ma per diventare turistica si deve fare che cosa? Deve schematizzare, bloccarsi, no? Lui ha fatto vedere la macchina del congela tradizione, che è troppo bella, io voglio fare la vostra con questa macchina, quindi ora lo prepariamo, amico. Si è bloccata per questo, cosa diversa per dire la festa, potrei citare tanti casi di feste di San Giuseppe, che sono, diciamo, uno dei miei ambiti di ricerca degli ultimi 15-20 anni, però un caso emblematico per tutti, la festa di San Giuseppe a Mirabella in Baccari, che è un piccolo paese in provincia di Catania, dove i pani rituali, pur in presenza di pani rituali altamente, fortemente connotati in maniera tradizionale, direi anche, userei anche il termine arcaico, anche se è proibito, e quindi il pane con doppia spirale, che aprono la tavola di San Giuseppe, all'interno di queste grandi tavolate abbiamo che cosa? Anche il fustino di Dixan, l'olio di semi, cioè beni primari che servono, perché la tavola di San Giuseppe fondamentalmente, poi i beni che si espongono in questa tavola vengono distribuiti e ridistribuiti alla comunità, quindi beni primari che servono a quella comunità, quindi sono ancora oggi funzionali. Ecco perché troviamo il fustino di Dixan sulla tavola di San Giuseppe, perché è ancora attiva, viva e funzionale. Cosa che non è per dire la tavola di San Giuseppe e la festa di San Giuseppe a Saleni, che invece è bloccata, sclerotizzata nella forma estetica della realizzazione del pane, che deve essere esteticamente bello. Spero di essere stato chiaro in questa confusa risposta.
Grégoire wants to add shortly to the discussion, no?
A question, because in the exhibition where we have the tradizo, we also have a machine to distillate, so to make discourses from objects, about objects. And so that was the point, perhaps, about this project of collaboration. Where do we stop? Where do we stop to have all the significance about objects? We can never stop. we can and the role of the museum is also to congelate, to freeze perhaps, yes, and to freeze and perhaps not to freeze but to give a frame, to give an advice, to give a point of view. And in that kind of collaborative projects, there's a lot of, for me, it's this question, where do you stop? Where do you stop? Because you can never stop. And you can add things and any intangible discourses to you, objects, and then you, and this is always a question for the museum, where do we stop? Where? In collecting the object, and collecting the discourses, and collecting the archive, because as Baudrillard said, il n'y a pas assez de place pour le monde à son double. So.
Thank you. Do we have other questions in the audience?
Allora, buongiorno, grazie per questa grande opportunità. Io sono Adriana Gandolfi, dal Museo delle Genti d'Abruzzo di Pescara. E, mi riferisco sia agli interventi che faceva Rosario, sia Mario, e anche a quello che si faceva prima con la professoressa, non mi ricordo, Black.
No? Sì.
Black, e allora, per quanto riguarda la professoressa Blake, mi aveva incuriosito, poi era entrato l'auto con le sue argomentazioni. Noi che siamo ricercatori, che siamo coloro che a un certo punto hanno salvato per trasformarlo verso il futuro del materiale che negli ultimi 30-35 anni si era conservato, sfilacciato, comunque abbiamo salvato, per fare in modo che i soggetti portatori lo riutilizzassero o fossero padroni di farne quello che volevano. Perché appunto la storia delle tradizioni popolari, l'antropologia culturale, una volta si chiamavano tradizioni popolari queste, quando io parlo di folklore, quando io parlo di folklore adesso io, è una maniera di sminuire, perché? Perché purtroppo ci sono degli interventi che partono dalle tradizioni, cercano di congelarle con la sua macchina che mi è piaciuta da morire, e certe volte, come sta accadendo adesso, le stanno violentando. Mi spiego, ci sono gruppuscoli che lavorano su materiali che noi ricercatori abbiamo traslato verso il futuro. Abbiamo fatto libri, Busek per esempio, faccio un esempio proprio sul carnevale, perché lo volevo fare prima con l'intervento della tutela. Allora, io ho lavorato moltissimo sul carnevale e ho partecipato pure a quel bellissimo libro, quella ricerca con Kezic, Carnival dell'Europa, che è bellissimo, che fa vedere tutta la tradizione, c'è questo filo rosso che lega le Alpi con i Pirenei, l'Appennino centro-meridionale, con queste maschere stupende che poi vengono continuamente rielaborate a distanza di anni. Io sono 30 anni che li studio e ogni volta che ci vado vedo cose bellissime, nuove, anche ardite, come appunto il Tixan che viene dato come bene, bene da usare, va bene. Che succede? Ci sono questi gruppi cittadini adesso, mo c'è la città, che fa un'operazione da ventennio, post-ventennio. Sì, bravo, allora, veramente, guarda, comincerei a distribuire veramente al cianuro, perché facciamo tanto per restituire una cultura dell'identità a chiunque, arrivano questi che non hanno mai capito di me, però si devono travestire, giusto? E invece di fare più i gruppi folcloristici che almeno fanno i coretti, se la cantano, se la suonano, si mettono, non sono costumi, sono divise, ok? No, adesso ci sono questi gruppi capeggiati dai Sai Baba della tradizione, che placano le persone, che si mettono perché hanno una posizione di prestigio, tipo professore universitario, professore di scuola, ma di altre materie che non c'entrano niente, copiano le cose che hanno visto, non vanno manco in ricerca sui territori, vanno, capito, vengono a sentire le mie conferenze, poi rifanno quei costumi che hanno visto, poi vengono al museo da me e mi donano i loro costumi rifatti, quando io ho gli originali, e che succede? Violentano la realtà che è ancora viva. Quindi portatori della tradizione esistono ancora, e loro sono padroni di elaborare o di farlo finire in malora questo carnevale. Come ci dobbiamo comportare rispetto a queste cose? Perché è veramente un rischio, noi vediamo, cioè in contesti cittadini, questi carnevali arcaici stupendi che non sono più arcaici, sono, cioè li bruciano, bruciano queste maschere che sono fuori contesto, sono maschere silvestri, sono maschere che stanno bene nei paesi dove devi camminare in cima alla montagna, dove ti escono da dietro un muro, cioè, ecco. Allora, queste le mie sono due.
Chi hai fatto la domanda?
Allora, giuristi l'ho fatto, ho fatto una cosa triangolare, come c'è mio figlio da piccolo, triangolata. Da giuristi, come l'ho fatto stamattina, come ci dobbiamo comportare? Cioè, qual è la prassi? E voi
so dire... I think we need to have a group discussion.
Sì.
So I would like to
e poi due, allora, è giusto, capito, opporsi a questa cosa o no?
Io ho capito che c'è fatto la domanda.
A
tutte e due.
Non era una domanda.
Era una considerazione, va bene.
Beh, I think it is showing or illustrating how much these questions are a contact zone or a zone of dialogue and conflict. But maybe that while analyzing what's living in all this discussion, we can also give space for other issues or questions that live in the audience.